Hello and welcome to Hot Issues. Now, this week, we are taking a look at international relations and we'll mix it with local politics. Probably take a look at the chances of the National Democratic Congress in this election. We'll look at the role of women in national politics and we'll perhaps zero in on one of the 275 constituencies and see what is happening there. Britain just exited the European Union. Would this have consequences for Ghana? How does that affect trade between Ghana and Britain and generally trade with the European Union? What are the full foreign policy implications of the exit of Britain from the European Union? 2016 is undoubtedly the election year and we have just a few months to elections. How are the parties faring? How is the National Democratic Congress preparing for this election? And then we'll zero in on the Ewutu Senya constituency, where a foreign minister is contesting elections to go to parliament. Welcome to Hot Issues. And we are very, very privileged to have with us in the studio, Madam Hannah Tetteh, the foreign minister. Madam, you're welcome to the studio.
Thank you, Kwesi. It's a pleasure.
How do you assess, first of all, how did the exit of Britain from the European Union, how did it hit you?
It wasn't a surprise because I had been following developments ever since David Cameron declared that there was going to be a referendum on the issue. And I had been following the commentary, not just watching the news, but also reading articles from a number of UK papers. And the closer it got to the day of the referendum, it was clear that the arguments that had been put forward by the Leave campaigners were having quite some resonance, especially as regards the subject of immigration. Mm-hmm. And I recall asking one of the EU ambassadors about a week before the vote took place. I said, so what happens if the UK votes to leave? And the person's remark was, I don't think so. There are too many advantages in it for them. And I said, well, the way things are going, it could be a real possibility. And the response was still, I don't think so. I think that we believe that whatever it is, Britain would vote to remain. So I was in a state of mind where I felt anything could happen. And when I had the opportunity to speak to the British High Commissioner before the elections, his reaction also told me, even though he didn't say anything expressly, his reaction also told me that indeed anything could happen. So no, it wasn't a surprise. Now, the question is, going forward, what happens? When David Cameron indicated that he was going to resign as Prime Minister, you recall that he said that he would stay on until October because that was when he expected that they would have voted a new party leader in place. In any event, he hoped that by the time of the Conservative Party conference in October, there'd be a new Prime Minister. And then if you recall, he also said that it would be the job of the next Prime Minister to start the Article 50 negotiations for exiting the European Union. Mm. So as at today, as you and I are having this discussion, the status quo remains. Mm-hmm. Britain is still legally a member of the European Union, though it has voted to leave. And therefore it is when those negotiations are concluded that we'll have a clearer picture of what comes next.
But there are countries in Europe which have said that they are not waiting till October. Indeed, the president of the European Council has said that they want the negotiations now.
Well, but what is also clear is that it is only the country that is leaving that has the right to start the process. Mm. And so it's in as much as the others might wish for a rapid progress on discussing this issue and concluding, it doesn't look like that's going to happen anytime soon. This morning, I listened to Theresa May when she was making her statement for her leadership bid of the Conservative Party. And what she said was that they would not actually call for Article 50 negotiations to start until the end of the year. Mm-hmm. Because what the UK needed to do before they invoked that clause was to have their own negotiation strategy ready. Mm-hmm. And so if she were elected the leader of the Conservative Party, she would not be taking that decision until the end of the year. So notwithstanding the fact that I'm sure the rest of the EU member states do want to see some progress made on this issue, it still is, the agenda and the timing is still very much controlled by the UK.
What about other implications for the United Kingdom beyond just negotiating Article 50 and so on? What are some of the implications for the United Kingdom? There's been talk about Scotland, there's been talk about Ireland and so on. What are some of these implications?
Well, I mean, we can just speculate, isn't it? Because there's nothing that is really conclusive. But it is clear that Scotland wanted to stay in the European Union. They voted massively to stay. Northern Ireland also wanted to stay in the European Union. Mm. They voted massively to stay. Would there be the possibility, because already Gerry Adams of Sinn Féin has already fired that first salvo, that this is now time to look at Irish reunification? Because they would have more in common with the Republic of Ireland than with the United Kingdom. But again, that's a matter that will unfold in the months to come. Mm-hmm. It's also quite clear that the First Minister of Scotland, Nicola Sturgeon, has also made her own overtures to the European Union. Spain has indicated that it would block Scotland's application to join the European Union because it would, of course, then create a precedent for its Catalan region, which is also looking to secede from Spain. So it tells us that we're going into a period of uncertainty. And there will be, very likely, others who would want to take advantage of this situation to try and test whether their countries would be ready to take a similar action. And there obviously are other states within the United Kingdom that are thinking about whether their future is indeed still within the United Kingdom.
In fact, there has been some agitation in France for a referendum.
I wouldn't call that agitation. Let's say that the leader of the far-right party, Marie Le Pen, who is very much like Nigel Farage of UKIP, wants to have a referendum. She's also started making that request. The question really is whether that gains any traction with the French population as a whole, such that the matter has to be put to a referendum. Remember that before the UK came to this, it was very much a topical issue in their last election. And therefore, to bring some closure to the matter, the then Conservative Prime Minister, well, still Conservative Prime Minister, David Cameron, said that the issue would be put to a referendum. So again, yes, there are some far-right parties within member states of the EU that have similar positions on immigration, and therefore being driven by those particular concerns are also suggesting that they should put that to the vote. But we have to see what kind of response the population as a whole gives to that kind of rhetoric.
Now, these are the ramifications for Europe and for UK and so on. What about us? What would this do to us? Would it do anything to our relationship with the EU and Britain?
Well, let's start first with our relationship with the UK. We have a bilateral relationship with the UK that goes back centuries, from our colonial history to the present. That bilateral relationship, to the best of my knowledge and to the best of my belief, is not likely to change. Remember that we have relations with the UK outside of the UK having been an EU member state. We also have relations with the UK within the Commonwealth. And we have a number of programs that are of a bilateral nature and not within the context of UK-EU-Ghana relations. Will there be more, I suppose, space to have discussions on matters that previously were handled exclusively by the European Union on behalf of its member states, yes. But that will be when they complete their negotiations. And the reason why I'm saying that is because these are questions that I had already posed both to the British High Commissioner, and I had a discussion earlier this morning with the Minister of State of the Foreign Office. And these were some of the issues that I raised. And the points that were made were that, you know, right now, between these two personalities, two UK public officials, that right now their first priority was to conclude negotiations with the European Union. And then it was after that that there would be the space to also have other negotiations taking place at a bilateral level. So given that it is anticipated that these Article 50 negotiations can take up to 2 years, chances are that for the next 2 years, we're not really going to be in a position to have those discussions.
What about the economic partnership agreement that we signed with the EU? How would this impact that?
Well, two things. Remember, there are two economic partnership agreements. There's the Interim Economic Partnership Agreement, and then there's the ECOWAS Economic Partnership Agreement. At the moment, we're not talking about the ECOWAS Economic Partnership Agreement because not all our member states have signed. So our fallback position is our Interim Economic Partnership Agreement. Now, my understanding on that as well, again, having consulted with the UK and also having consulted with the EU, is that for now, until Article 50 negotiations are concluded, Britain is still a member of the free trade area, still has the rights and obligations of a state within the free trade area. And therefore, an economic partnership agreement signed between Ghana and the EU would also apply to our exports to the United Kingdom and imports from the United Kingdom under the tariff liberalization schedule that is set by either of those agreements. However, after they conclude Article 50 negotiations, there will be the opportunity to negotiate another agreement. But having said that, it might not be very different from the one we have right now. Because remember that the UK is not so much of an agricultural producing nation anymore. As a matter of fact, their strength is in services. The EPA that we have is a trade in goods agreement. We haven't commenced a negotiation on trade in services. We're not about to start a negotiation on trade in services anytime soon, to the best of my knowledge. But that is where the UK has its comparative advantage. And so after the EU Article 50 negotiations are concluded, it may be the case that they will approach us not just to have a discussion on trading goods, but also to have a discussion on trade and services.
It's obvious that the agitation throughout Europe, you know, for a breakaway from the European Union is hinged somehow on anti-foreigner sentiments. How does that affect us?
Well, even before there was the referendum, remember that in response to the huge migration of people fleeing from conflict in Syria and Iraq over the last year especially, and also fleeing from Libya across the Mediterranean through Italy and also across the Mediterranean through Greece, through Turkey and through Greece. With that huge influx of refugees, there was a very negative response from the different countries of the European Union, because if my reading of the sentiment is right, it's because they felt that they were being swamped by persons from a different culture. And I think one of the considerations also was that the refugees coming in were predominantly seen to be Muslim refugees. And especially because of the way that in the public mind, I'm not saying that is the way that it is, but I'm saying the way that it is presented in the media. Because of the link between Islam and terrorism, there was this apprehension that was played upon by a number of far-right groups to try and create the impression that all of these people who are coming in are threats to their societies and to their stability. So you will recall that last year there was actually an EU-Africa conference on migration mm-hmm. in Valletta, in Malta, where a number of these issues concerning migration between Africa and the EU were discussed. So it is not an issue fueled by Brexit. It is an issue that gains currency, has had currency to some extent or the other over the years, but gained much more currency over the last year. Mm. Will it continue to be an issue for the next year? I assume that it will. But the point is that when it comes to refugees, there are international laws, there are international conventions that we have all signed up to. And for especially countries of the European Union that are constantly reminding developing countries about the need to respect human rights, it is now their turn to respect those human rights that they have been advocating for us to also pay much more attention to. Please don't get me wrong. I think it is absolutely necessary for us also to respect the human rights of individuals. We have very elaborate human rights provisions in our constitution. I'm just saying that right now they are faced with a crisis where they also have to live up to some of the standards that they have been pressing upon others. And that is certainly quite clearly a challenge for them.
There is a moral question. I mean, if Europeans are worried about our people going there and taking their jobs and so on, why shouldn't we be worried about their coming here and taking our resources virtually for free? They are in our gold mines, they are involved with the mining of bauxite and so on. They are taking resources.
Yes, they are. They are taking resources, but remember, it's within the frame of our own legal construct. Now, if we think that the terms on which those activities are going on are disadvantageous to us, then the onus is on us to amend our policy and our legislation so as to make it more difficult for them to come and take, to use your expression, mm-hmm. our resources virtually for free. I think that it's important for us to distinguish between a couple of things. The refugee crisis is a humanitarian crisis. And yes, I just made the point that their reaction to it has not been quite the best. Mm-hmm. And now they are going to have to deal with that challenge. If we had to deal with the refugee crisis, we also would have to see how we would also meet our international obligations. When it comes to coming into our country for the purposes of staying and investing in our country, we have defined the framework by which we are inviting people to come and stay. And if for one reason or the other we think that that framework is inadequate to protect our society, also to make sure that we get value, sufficient value out of the transaction, it's for us to begin the process of reviewing that.
But sometimes it is suggested that that framework was not freely chosen by us, and that through threats and so on, sometimes we adopt some of these frameworks.
You know, I think that when we say things like that, we pass the buck too easily. We are effectively abdicating responsibility for decisions that we've taken. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we may have taken decisions without enough information. And subsequently, upon actually implementing a framework, a legal framework, we find out that there are challenges within the framework. I think nothing should stop us in that context to go back and say, you know, we did this in good faith. We thought that we had protected against mm-hmm. what we consider to be things that were disadvantageous to us. We thought that there were certain excesses that we had created enough space to contain. We are not satisfied with how we see this whole process is unfolding. And so we now need to go back, review, and make amendments in order to make this much more acceptable for us, looking at what we consider to be our interests and how we want to grow our economy. And so I think that we shouldn't, you know, always create the opportunity and give ourselves the excuse that somebody compelled us to do something. We may have been confronted with perhaps two bad choices, mm-hmm. and that we may have taken the lesser evil of the two bad choices. If we now think that we are in a position to do something about that, let's address that as an issue, mm-hmm. you know, as opposed to passing the buck.
Now we're going to look at foreign involvement in election 2016. Now, madam, when the British High Commissioner, the UK High Commissioner, says that they are not interested as a country, government, in the outcome of the elections, do you believe him?
Well, quite frankly, he has no business being interested in the outcome of our elections, as neither does any other state which has a diplomatic presence in Ghana. And so if he says that, I take it that it's a recognition that that is the way that it ought to be.
But that is not the way it is. A gentleman called Colin Bloom, described as the outreach director of the Conservative Party, was in the country last week. And he has made public statements to the effect that Ghana needs to change government and that the people of Ghana deserve better. The foreign minister, what's your reaction?
My reaction to Mr. Bloom is that it's none of his business. At the moment, the Conservative Party has challenges of its own. We wish them all the best as they deal with those challenges. They should deal with theirs and leave theirs for the Ghanaian people to decide.
But some have argued that for as long as we keep going to them for assistance, for our electoral processes and so on, they then have a stake in our elections.
Well, they have a stake in maintaining the credibility of our elections, if you want to put it that way, because the reason why they provide resources ostensibly is to make sure that we can conduct a free and fair election and that the process is transparent. That is where their interest begins and ends. The choices that the Ghanaian people make are choices for the Ghanaian people to make. And it's not their prerogative to do otherwise.
Madam, you're a foreign minister, but you're also a very, very well-known, strong member of the National Democratic Congress. Is your party ready for 2016?
Because every election has its challenges based on the circumstances in which our country finds itself, both in terms of domestic challenges and also looking at the externals that affect us, whether we like it or not. For any party at any time, when legally, constitutionally, the election is due, the issue is not whether you are ready or not. The issue is that it is time to go to the country for an election. And you have to prepare to go to the country for an election. And the National Democratic Congress has already started preparing, has already started campaigning, and you will see we'll do so much more vigorously as we get closer to our election date.
Your opponents have been harping on one issue, unemployment. Is it true that you haven't done enough to deal with the unemployment situation?
It is true that we have a rapidly growing youth population. And so because of that, we have to do much more than perhaps we needed to do 10 years ago to meet the demands for jobs for a growing youth population. Now, so that's the way that I would answer the question, because it's not a question of have we done enough or have we not done enough. The youth bulge mm-hmm. is a challenge for every country on this continent, and even for countries outside of this continent. As we've seen improvements in healthcare, as we've seen improvements in nutrition, education, country standards of living have improved. What it has happened is that you have less children dying as a result of the early childhood, the killer diseases. You have less infant mortality. After all, the whole MDG process was about reducing poverty, improving the standard of living, making education much more accessible, giving young people the opportunity to grow in a reasonably healthy environment so that they would have a better chance of growing to adulthood and making something out of themselves. The success that has been achieved globally in delivering on the MDG objectives, even though we haven't met all of the targets and now we've gone into the SDGs, says that we are at a situation where we have to, it's an extraordinary situation, and we need to think about extraordinary measures to be able to deal with the challenge of youth unemployment. But it is not a uniquely Ghanaian challenge. It is currently a global challenge.
Your opponents are also harping on their belief that we have not done enough to fight corruption.
I disagree with that. I think that, you know, we have fought corruption. We have introduced legislation. Public officials, my colleagues who have been accused of acts of corruption, there have been investigations. Some prosecutions are still ongoing. We have improved the legislative framework. We have also given greater powers to what was then the SFO and made it the Economic and Organized Crime Office, and giving it a broader mandate to investigate white collar crime, which is essentially most of the criminal activity, which also involves acts of corruption. And of course, we have a much more transparent media environment. We have a very free press, which I think we're all very proud of. And so because of that, we find that issues are put out in the public domain and they are reported on. And as a result of which, people are much more aware of allegations, of instances. Look at the Public Accounts Committee's hearings. Mm-hmm. Whenever I attend public accounts as a Minister of State, I know that I'm expected to respond to issues of how was government money used, dispersed, and if it was not used properly, what have you done to try and recover those sums or to make the people who were responsible for those actions accountable? Now, to say that we are not fighting corruption because instances of corruption are reported with more frequency, all right, does not deal with the issue. The question really is not how frequently are they reported. The question is, subsequent to that, what actions are taken? Mm-hmm. And you would recognize that as and when the issues have come up and where it was necessary for prosecutions to begin and where it was felt that there was enough evidence to be able to bring a prosecution, those actions have been taken. But we must also recognize another thing, that our criminal law puts a very high obligation on the state to prove the guilt of an individual when it comes to criminal offenses for which you can be imprisoned. Mm. And remember that you have to prove your case beyond all reasonable doubt. So the kind of things that make newspaper headlines and are sensational may not necessarily hold in a court of law as acts that can be directly attributed to as acts of corruption that an individual has engaged in. So I think that that criticism is quite populist and unfair.
Now I'm going to ask a question which may even be unfair.
Okay.
But the Ford expedition, which mm-hmm. was given to the president as a gift by a Burkinabe contractor, came through the Ghanaian ambassador in Burkina Faso who works under you.
Actually, at that time I was not foreign minister. So because this happened before 2012, but yes, please go on.
Yes. Now, if ambassadors mm-hmm. received gifts for the president, would you consider it proper?
Well, I would say that, you know, the president does not receive gifts of that nature in a personal capacity. And I would tell them that those gifts cannot be meant for the president, but if someone wants to give a gift to the state, then it should be properly documented as a state property, which, by the way, is what was done in this instance. Because what happened was that even though there was the Ford Expedition vehicle that was sent through our embassy in Burkina Faso, and actually, I understand, was escorted to Accra by a regional minister, this vehicle was not received by President Mahama as a personal gift. He immediately said that it should be put into the pool of official castle vehicles. Mm-hmm. And as such, it never became a personal property for which you would say that he has obtained some personal advantage, and as a result of which he could be influenced one way or the other. So I think that the act by the ambassador to actually have received this was wrong, because I would not encourage any ambassador to receive any such gift on behalf of the state. If the person wants to do something, they can do a social responsibility project by building a school somewhere or refurbishing a hospital or something that would have a greater benefit to a larger community of people and nothing to do with a government official. But having said that, in this particular instance, President Mahama did not receive a personal gift. He actually handed it over as soon as it was made available to him to the government. So you cannot accuse him of corruption in a situation where he has not received a personal gift. This Ford expedition, which we've heard so much about in the papers recently.
Now, Madam, one of the issues which has generated a lot of controversy is what has come to be known as the Gitmo 2. I understand that it's in court now, and therefore we cannot discuss it in detail. But broadly speaking, under what circumstances did we agree to receive the Gitmo 2 in Accra?
Well, what it was that initially the U.S. government approached me, that they wanted to, President Obama was looking to shut down Guantanamo, which is one of the things that he campaigned on when he was first elected, and that they were having some issues with relocating some of the inmates who it was felt that if they went back to their countries of origin, were likely to re-engage with those same organizations that they had suspected, they had been suspected or found to be part of. And as a result of which, they were looking to have them relocated for a period of 2 years. And after that, they could move on. And so, after they had discussed with me, my view was that this was a decision that was above my pay grade. And so I informed His Excellency the President that this is the approach that had been made. He subsequently also was approached by the US ambassador at the time, Ambassador Kretz. He was also approached by President Obama. And it was subsequent to his conversation with President Obama that he said that he had agreed that we should receive two of the, no, actually the request was initially for three, that he had indicated that we would receive some of the detainees. So the next steps were that we asked our ambassador in the US, Ambassador Smith, to go to Guantanamo and to interview those who we were being requested to take and to make information available to the government as to what his views were about the particular individuals. And following that, there were other discussions until such time as they, and we exchanged diplomatic notes that covered the decision to receive them. But subsequently, in more detail, as to the specifics of how they would be treated when they came to Ghana, that was discussed between the National Security Coordinator's Office and the U.S. Embassy. Mm.
Now, did you believe the United States when they told you that those ex-detainees were safe?
The thing was, they made reports about them available. Those reports were reviewed by persons who, I believe, within our security apparatus, are in a position to assess what the implications of those reports about the detainees were, and therefore were in a position to advise as to whether we should accept them into the country or not.
Now, Madam, you're a foreign minister. I understand one of the most suspected foreign ministers in Africa. Why do you want to go to Parliament?
Because, you see, when you are politician. I think that you are at your most effective when you are able to maintain a continuous link between yourself and your constituents, the public. And in this instance, a microcosm, if you like, of the whole Ghanaian state is the population within your constituency. I think that it's very good that our constitutional provisions suggest that you can only contest for election in a place where you have resided for a period of time or a place where you come from, because it shows that you must have a real connection to the people who you seek to represent. For me, one of the most satisfying experiences in politics has been being a member of parliament. It keeps me very grounded, because even though I travel a lot these days and attend all of these conferences and important meetings where we are talking about global issues, these are issues at, if you like, 10,000 feet.
Mm-hmm.
But ultimately, you've got to think about how does this impact the person in my village who lives next door to me? When we decide that we are going to follow up on the Millennium Development Goals with the Sustainable Development Goals, in real terms, what does that mean for our national planning? What does that mean for our district level planning? What does that mean in terms of changing the life, improving the living conditions of someone who lives in my village and who will continue to live there in the foreseeable future, because that is where they have made their lives and is expecting to see that government policy and government action is going to deliver indeed some change that will create an improvement. And so I think that it's very important to retain that contact. The other thing also is that when you decide policy at the executive level, you give effect to policy through legislation. And so because of that, the kind of legislation that we pass as bills in parliament that become laws have a very significant impact on our development process going forward. And so once you are part of government, the whole nexus of policy development, decision-making, legislation requires you to have, in my mind, to be effective, a much broader view than that of just being an appointed public office holder. And so it is my choice to contest for election in 2012. I am grateful that the people of Awutu Senya West elected me. It has been my honor to be their member of parliament, and I am presenting myself for election again.
But as foreign minister, you're affecting lives in your constituency, you're affecting lives in Ghana, West Africa, and Africa, and so on.
Yes, but you see, Awutu Senya is where I come from. And when I say where I come from, I don't just say that because that's where my father came from. It's the place for me where I have my closest and real connection to Ghana. When I came to Ghana first, when I was about 8 and a half going on 9, and the first time we went to my village, Obrecha, to go and visit my grandmother and grandfather in the village, you can imagine for a child who had grown up until that time in the UK, the vast contrast between the life that and the living standards that we had come from to what we saw in the village. And throughout my father's life, for as long as I saw him as he was here and before he died, he always talked about how he could give back and how he could improve. So the secondary school that was established in my village, Obrecha Senior High School, was a secondary school that was actually established on our family land, because we gave the land freely so that the school could be located right there, because it would give more children mm-hmm. from the village and its environs the opportunity to have a secondary education and have a tertiary education. Whenever he did any projects to do, and he did a lot of projects on his own, with his own resources, because he was a private medical practitioner, he had his own clinic, he wasn't looking to government to support him in these initiatives. And he always felt that, you know, if you didn't make a difference where you came from, then you didn't give back to your people, you hadn't really done the best service that you could do. He was the person who encouraged me to contest for the Awutu Senya parliamentary seat for the very first time. Unfortunately, after he had persuaded me that this was a good idea, he passed, he had a heart attack and he passed away. And so I was left to either go ahead or, you know, to abandon the whole idea. But I felt that I owed it to him to try. If I contested and I won, then I had the opportunity to do something. If I lost, at least I had tried. Right now, as a member of parliament for Awutu Senya West, whenever I do anything by way of a project or an initiative that I can see makes a difference in people's lives and changes the lives of a few families, or maybe in some instances, many more individuals, I get a lot of personal satisfaction from doing that. That's the reason why I do it.
We are talking to Madam Hannah Sewa Tetteh, Ghana's foreign minister. You're looking at Brexit, its impact in Europe, specifically within the European Union. You're talking about election 2016, and we are talking about her interest in retaining her seat as a member of parliament. Now, madam, what are the issues in the constituency? What is the election about, you know, what you say now?
It's about development, really. It's about development. For a predominantly rural constituency, it is about development. Awutu Senya West used to be part of, at the time when I contested election the first time, it was part of the Awutu Efutu Senya constituency, which means including Winneba and Kaswa. And one of the issues that had a lot of strong resonance with the constituents was that they felt they were being left out, in the sense of whenever funds were allocated to the district, because Winneba and Kaswa were relatively bigger urban settlements with a myriad of urban problems and with, of course, a very vocal, concentrated population, their issues got attended to before issues in the rural communities got attended to. And so there was at some point in time some effort to petition the then government of President Kufuor for a division of the district into Efutu and then Awutu Senya, which happened and which resulted in perhaps more attention being paid to Awutu Senya as a district on its own. But then, of course, as Kaswa began to grow by leaps and bounds, then pretty much the same challenge that had affected the then Awutu Efutu Senya district now affected Awutu Senya district. Here was Kaswa, a rapidly growing urban metropolis with a huge amount of infrastructure needs that were required to make it a livable township. And at the same time, here you had these over 130 communities that made up the rest of the then Awutu Senya district that also required serious attention and development. And so as we had the division of the districts again to now Awutu Senya East, which is municipal, which is Kaswa, and Awutu Senya District, which is also Awutu Senya West constituency where I represent, what has happened over this last 3.5 years is that it's given us the opportunity to concentrate resources on delivering more of the critical infrastructure that is required for this part of the district. Now, even though we have done quite a bit by way of educational infrastructure, healthcare infrastructure, feeder roads, law and order, job creation, there is still the opportunity to do a lot more because of the demands of the area. So really, the issue is about development. The election
when
is about development.
When you talk about educational infrastructure, what are we talking about? You mean you built more schools? What is it?
We have built more schools. We have renovated, rehabilitated, and built more schools. And we also, in the process of having one of these model senior high schools completed, so that we will actually now have 3 senior high schools in the district. And with the 4th one, which we have also begun development, so we believe that that also, we don't anticipate that that will be finished before the election, but it will create greater opportunities for senior high education and also building many more junior high schools as well. And again, the challenge has been a rapidly growing population, a lot of young people, increasingly lower rates of infant mortality and the demand for kindergartens and primary schools and junior high schools and senior high schools so that children from the district can be able to have their educational needs met and at the same time can stay in the district, not cost that much to their parents to give them an education and give them the opportunity to go to a tertiary institution as well. And the healthcare issues, because again, with a lot of widespread rural communities, we have four health centers. We have been promised by the Ministry of Health a district hospital. And we also told that we'll do the sword cutting for it very soon. I'm really pushing on that because that is perhaps the last piece of the puzzle. But we have a registered voting population of almost 70,000. Mm-hmm. Now that is, by our estimates, we have an actual population of about over 150,000. I'm saying, you know, a rough estimate because I can't be that definite about that figure. But if you have a voting population of almost 70,000, especially after this recent registration exercise, it gives you an indication of the number of people you're dealing with. And so we need more of that kind of infrastructure to be able to cope with the needs of the constituents and to give them the opportunity to have access to those services without having to go to Winneba or Swedru or Kaswa if they need to have treatment, if they need to be able to report an incident to the police, if they want their children to go to senior high school, if they want to be able to do their small, to have the facilities to be able to improve their small and medium businesses within the constituency.
Now, recently it was reported that under your initiative, the Ayensu starch factory is back to life. Is that true?
Ayensu starch never shut down. Mm. I think it's, and I've said this in previous interviews, but the point was Ayensu starch could not meet the potential demand that now exists for its products. And the Ministry of Trade and the government was not in a position to recapitalize the company. When I was the Minister of Trade and Industry, there was, I think it was in 2009, when we had our first budget, I'm not sure whether it was 2009 or 2010, but around then, that the Ministry of Finance introduced an excise tax on beverages, alcoholic and non-alcoholic. And the breweries were up in arms that this was making them uncompetitive. And one of the things they said was that they were trying to develop local content for the use and the production of their beverages. And if they now had to have to pay that amount of tax was charged on their product, then it would make it uncompetitive and they couldn't sustain those initiatives. So in discussion with the Ministry of Finance, we said, okay, we'll give you a challenge. The more local content you can use, the lower the tax. So we developed, in consultation with them, a sliding scale so that there would be an incentive for using more local content. And it was after we passed that piece of legislation that Guinness Ghana Breweries then approached the Ministry of Trade with a view to using starch for the production of beer. And their point was that they were in a position to use starch that to replace, I think it was barley, and that would, of course, reduce the cost of the product, but at the same time would meet the requirement of local content. So they started buying from Ayensu and actually provided credit facilities to Ayensu to be able to process on their behalf. The product's root beer apparently has been quite successful, but they're not able to keep up with demand. Ayensu was also not in a position to keep up with the ministry, with the company's demand. Mm. And so the current Minister of Trade and Industry, Honorable Spio Gabra, presented to Cabinet a proposal to have a public-private partnership established so that about 70% of the company's shares could be sold to a private investor who would be able to inject the required capital for Ayensu to be able to expand its production and meet the demands of its key customer, but also look for other customers as well.
Mm. Well, madam, thank you very much for coming.
You're welcome. Thank you, too.
It's been a pleasure. Well, viewers, we've been talking to Madam Hannah Tetteh Tetteh, Ghana's Minister of Foreign Affairs. We've been talking about Brexit, how it would affect us, how it would affect the European Union, election 2016, and her own effort to retain her seat in Parliament. I think that we've all learnt a thing or two. And as I always say, the best is on this channel.